25. First light of day. At first, it's not easy to see. A glimmer of early morning light peeks through the drawn curtains and the narrow space between the black flax panels. My body is rigid and weary as I depart from my place. If I dozed off for 15 minutes on the couch, that was it. If not, I would not get any sleep. My mind wandered to Ben and Caitlin all night long. I imagined them together, and I wondered if Ben or Caitlin had retrieved our high school yearbooks from the built-in bookcase in the condo's living room. I wondered if they had read them aloud, perhaps while cuddled up in bed, and if they had used them for research or reference. The yearbook had a photo of my doubles partner Mandy Cho and me, standing with our arms intertwined, exhausted and happy, after we had won a match. Recalling our coffee date, I recall Caitlin asking, "Aside from Ben, do you still keep in touch with anyone else from high school?" prior to inquiring about Mandy in particular. You can bet that she and Ben saw our yearbook photo together with Mandy. I step over to the window and draw back the curtain to get a better view of the outdoors. Still half awake, the street is peaceful, yet the sunshine brings solace. I try to convince myself that terrible things only happen at night, but I'm wrong. My thoughts have been preyed upon for the past 24 hours. I avert my gaze from the window and head into the kitchen to brew a pot of coffee. While on the road, my heart races as my phone alerts me to a new text message. "When are you free tonight?" "Hello, Ben." The heart is pounding. Reading this text transports me back to last night, when I was sitting on the couch next to him and asked him about his girlfriend's name. I remember thinking it was a harmless inquiry, maybe even flirtatious or taunting. It turns out I was incorrect. "Hi, Caitlin." That one word is all I can think of. I fixate on his facial expressions and the inflection of his voice to determine if he was aggressive or simply watching me with an inquisitive and knowing gaze, anticipating my response. In my shoes, I depart from the apartment and make my way to the basement, where I retrieve my personal copy of our high school yearbook. While sitting on the couch with the door locked, I turn through the pages, reliving moments like Ben and I on the homecoming court and during a football game. I am saddened to see Nat Cohen's beaming face as she holds a trophy in the top right corner of the tennis team page in the yearbook. Looking back, I realize that she would be dead in a few years later. I continue by turning the page. Classmates and instructors have scrawled short notes in a variety of colored ink on the inner covers of the yearbook, with sentiments like, "You're a great friend," and "Keep in touch" among them. I can't help but think about the note I would have written in Ben's yearbook, probably something sentimental about hearts, as it is an inside joke that only he and I would understand. Ben's note is on the back cover. I was wondering if he and Caitlin shared a giggle while reading it. Once again, my phone rings and I tense up. I grabbed for the phone and put the yearbook down. Ben has sent another text. "I'll make supper in the condo, as you desire." Our Lincoln Park condo was once shared by Ben, Sienna, and me. At this point, it is his. I lamented the condo nearly as much as I lamented Ben when we split up and Sienna and I departed. However, I am now terrified at the thought of coming there and being alone with him. I rarely respond. I set the phone down once more and attempt to block out Ben and the call, but the minutes tick by before the phone really rings, and I'm terrified by his relentlessness. He remains determined. Feeling sick and exhausted from stress and worry, I quickly glance at the phone. We now know it's not Ben. "Hello," I say as I pick up the phone and put it to my ear. "It's an HR representative from the hospital. They would prefer that I meet with them in person." The first rays of sunlight teased. As soon as it emerged, it vanished behind a wall of dense clouds that swept in swiftly. The day is little above 32 degrees, and the wind is howling, so instead of snow, I'm getting sleet that flies into my eyes. Upon entering my workplace, individuals initially fix their gaze upon me before consciously averting their eyes from mine. Everybody knows my name, what I did, and how I murdered a patient by this point. People wait in a conference room for me when I get to human resources so we can talk about what happened and go over the specifics again and again. Not everyone's face is familiar to me. They make their acquaintance. HR, risk management, the nurse manager, and more are all involved. I wish I had heeded the charge nurse's warning. A lawyer would have been a good choice for me. Hello, Megan. Happy morning. An individual respectfully requests that you take a seat. I take out a plush chair and slide onto it, but I still don't feel right. Their questioning moves throughout the room. What is your nursing experience? What is the duration of your treatment for Miss Beckett? Tell me how you ended up with Mrs. Laley's insulin pen in your pocket. Does scanning a patient's wristband before providing medication not happen frequently for you? When this happened, how did you feel mentally? It feels more like an interrogation than anything else, and I can tell from a way that their biggest concern is potential legal consequences. I need to be sure that the details I told yesterday remain unchanged when they ask inquiries. What follows is outlined by them. The state's nursing board will examine the report they submitted and determine whether or not they have authority based on their findings. An inquiry will be conducted by the board. They will inform my coworkers, my bosses, and the Becketts, who have the option to initiate civil charges independently. The board has to deliberate for a long time before they decide whether my actions are actionable, whether to suspend or revoke my nursing license, or impose any other penalty or none at all. I might walk free. As the inquiry continues, they placed me on administrative leave. Taking my time, I plod my way to the intensive care unit to retrieve my belongings from my locker before I depart. The question of whether or not I will return remains an open one. That this is occurring does not surprise me. Naturally, I anticipated consequences. I still haven't been let go, even though something was certain to happen. No one from security is showing me the way out of the building. Taking administrative leave is far from the worst possible outcome. Payday will still come. Advantages will still be mine. If this had escalated into a criminal issue and the cops had shown up, been waiting for me when I entered HR, or anything equally disastrous may have occurred. It is what it is. In the case that I lose my job or my license, I still have options, such as becoming a home health aide or finding a whole different line of work. I go to the break room to get my belongings before I head home, and I push the door open. Standing with her back to me, a woman in the room wears a lengthy, dark brown hairstyle that cascades over her shoulders and a stiff, white hospital gown that fastens at the back. She seems out of place in the staff break room. A wise grin spreads across her face as she looks back over her shoulder at me. As I take in her hair, eyes, and grin, I flinch in horror as she exclaims, "You're going to pay." I slam the door to the break room. "Hey, I'm Caitlin." It turns out she's still alive. She is feeling well. She spins around so I can see her in what appears to be a long, slim white doctor's smock rather than a hospital gown. Caitlin is not the one. We lost Caitlin. "Excuse me?" As I ask, my breath catches. The kind-hearted doctor continues, "I asked if I'm in your way." As I look at her with wide eyes and a mixture of confusion and relief, attempting to make out the features of Caitlin Beckett. As I say, "No," my voice is trembling. "Absolutely not." Her demeanor is gentle. After she goes, I sit down on a rough chair at the little round table to collect my belongings and take a deep breath since she has no idea who I am or what I've done. Her thoughtful grin betrays her lack of knowledge. As I'm ducking my arms inside my coat as I exit the break room, I spot two uniformed police officers walking down the hall. At the nurse's station, they stand over 6 feet tall and weigh 200 or 250 pounds. They're facing away from me, so all I can see is their stocky builds and massive shoulders. I run to the nearest wall, stand flush against it, duck behind a pilaster, my heart in a flat spin, and stammer an apology after my legs abruptly stop, causing someone to accidentally slam into me from behind. Here we have the police. My actions are known to them. I am being pursued by them. Paralyzed, I can only observe for an instant as they address the charged nurse from the desk. The officer is holding his sidearm in his holster with one hand. Gradually, I step back, and as soon as I am able to, I turn around and go back the way I came, making my way to the fire escape stairs down the corridor. As I step out of the building, thoughts of what I will say to Sienna upon my return fill my mind. 26. Still on edge from seeing the police at the hospital, I try to reassure myself that there could have been a dozen other reasons for their presence that were unrelated to me, like a violent patient or a criminal admitted for treatment. But I hear Sienna's voice as I enter the apartment later that morning. On my way to work, I looked up any new information regarding the investigation into Caitlin's attempted murder. I came across a photo of Milo Finch in a newspaper article from 2 days ago, which stated that the police are appealing to the public for assistance in locating him. This suggests that, as of 48 hours ago at least, they continue to believe that he was responsible, that he drove her to her breaking point, and she is unable to deny it. Even though it's a relief, my conscience wishes he's long since disappeared or found a safe haven. I hope he gets caught because if anyone has to go to jail for it, it would be him. Ben has attempted to phone and sent a third SMS. My voicemail has a message that needs my attention, but I just can't bring myself to answer it. Feeling emotionally overwhelmed, I walked home, my mind racing with thoughts of the police, Caitlin, my placement on administrative leave, the contents of my home, and whether or not Ben would be there to greet me. His answer is no. Upon initial inspection, it appears that the apartment is deserted, save for Sienna, who is cloistered in her bedroom after returning from her sleepover with Gianna. Standing just inside the door of the living room while shedding a damp winter coat, I overhear her and assume that she is conversing on the phone or using FaceTime with a friend, as her voice is muted and difficult to make out. She says something, but I can't make out a word, and then she laughs so loud it pierces the air. Sienna knew I didn't want her having boys in the apartment when I wasn't home, so she purposefully disobeyed me. I was going to shout out to her to let her know I'm home when I heard Nico's voice coming from behind the closed bedroom door. I tensed up, clenched my jaw, and turned red. Even worse, I can't help but wonder what they're up to in her bedroom because the door is closed. I take 3 steps to go across the room. On autopilot, I reach up to knock on the door. But then I see something in the corner of my eye and instinctively shift my gaze to the kitchen, letting my arm fall. It's so unusual for Sienna to have her phone out in the open like this, not tied to her hip, so I'm contacted by her phone as it lies on the kitchen table, lit up and facing up next to her overnight bag. Then, Nico is here and has her undivided attention. She probably thought I was going to be at work all day when I told her I was rushing into it, so she was surprised when I returned home to find him there. I step back from the entrance. My attention wanders to the phone. I will see Ben's name displayed on the screen when I reach it. He sent the incoming message. My pulse quickens. The most of the time, I would ignore Sienna's messages. But I can't help but think of last night him and I in this living room, his thumb resting on my neck, our eyes locked, our bodies moving in perfect harmony. On the opposite side of Sienna's door, Nico and she have fallen silent, their voices barely audible. I'm concerned about their whereabouts, but not more so than about the texts that Ben has sent to her. I take a hand on the phone. One of my requirements when she got her phone was that I always have access to it. After all, I'm the one who pays the bill, so it's technically mine. So I swiftly input her password to unlock it. Is your mom working or home today? That's the question Ben asked in his message. I squint and mutter under my breath. The idea that he's using Sienna as a means to contact me, that he's messaging her to see how I'm doing, is confusing to me. I am on the verge of putting the phone down again. Nevertheless, I eventually open my eyes and find myself swept up in the subsequent messages. I can make out Sienna's parting words to Ben just above this most recent text. She deceives. They're so painful and acidic that I can't help but wonder who is responsible. Tell me who lies. Just then, my name pops up. Before Ben tells Sienna, Mom said you had a headache, Sienna asks sharp questions in the previous chapter. What the? I take deeper breaths. I've been apprehended. You can call me a liar. Why? Because Ben had already asked, how is your head, in the last text, which he sent last night just after 10. I lied to Ben, and he knows it. He is aware that Sienna was not going to return home yesterday night, and that she did not suffer from a headache. That unsettles me. However, the most hurtful part is the sharp, jagged tone with which Sienna referred to me as a liar. She's quite resentful and resentful. She deceives. Looking back at yesterday evening, when Sienna texted Ben about how strange I was acting, makes my stomach knot up. Curious, huh? Inquiring, he reached out. I am uncertain. She merely is. Did you come home? Does she accompany you? Has anything occurred? No, I am uncertain. I was just instructed to visit Gianna's by her. Per her, I couldn't remain in this place. Sure, I think it's fine. Might it not be? Would you like me to see to it that she's okay? Yes. Yes. My chest has been aching recently, and a tightness has been creeping up its length. Under those circumstances, Ben was telling the truth. It was Sienna. She did request that he visit me for an assessment. It throws the entire evening into doubt in an instant. Had Ben's motivations not been as nefarious as I had suspected? Was his purpose in coming here truly altruistic? When did Sienna decide to deceive me? Just why would she accuse me of being dishonest? I quickly glance up from the phone before putting it in my pocket, since I don't have time to think about the possibilities because another unusual sound is emanating from Sienna's room. I proceed to Sienna's house, rap the door once, and then enter without asking for permission. I'm prepared to see them making out on Sienna's trundle bed under the pink and puckered comforter. I imagine Nico reaching over and grabbing her shirt, pawing at her chest. However, that is not the case. Sitting at her little desk, Nico appears much too tall for the pink children's desk chair that she has owned since she was a little girl. The sound of her pencil cup being knocked off the desk and dozens of pens and pencils falling to the floor was the first thing I heard. Sienna is crouched down beside the desk, picking them up with her bare hands while she cackles. You're such a fucking klutz, Sienna says as she gets to her feet in response to my sudden entrance. Mom, she adds, her voice filled with embarrassment as Nico frantically tries to hide his hands at the desk, causing a swath of blood to obscure whatever he was doing. Asking, why are you here? My home is here. It seems like you should be at work, don't you? Everything is done. I only had to attend a meeting today. Having boys about the flat when I'm not there was something we discussed, I thought. You never implied that I couldn't. Senia, I did indeed. Not at all, she adamantly denies it. You indicated that you needed time to consider it. Recalling our discussion, I see that she is not completely incorrect. That was my point. Asking, what are you two up to? I wonder, I say. I doubt I would have realized he was writing if Nico hadn't made such a hasty effort to conceal it. That's all, she says. It's not insignificant, Sienna. Describe it. She tries to explain it away by saying, just something for school, but by the time she finishes, Nico raises his hands and shows me what it is. With a crimson envelope resting on top of a ripped sheet of paper, Nico's signature all caps calligraphy begins to read, I know what you owe. A black pen is held in Nico's hand. In the hospital break room, I retrieved the red envelope, the one I'd taken that morning from the mailbox. It bore my name but no postmark or return address. And now, looking at the torn paper with its sawtooth edge transports me back to that day. That one that claimed to be a bitch. Since I couldn't have acquired it any other way, I assumed someone had broken into the building and dropped it off in the mailbox. Then again, what if the culprit just happened to have a key? My gaze darts between Sienna and the note, and then back again. Nico, I believe you should leave, I whisper. He then pushes back on the chair and stands up, dropping the pen to the desktop as he nods. Even though it's timid and fearful, Nico says farewell. However, he knows he's been caught because Sienna's reaction is so characteristic of her. As I make my way to the living room, she escorts Nico out into the hallway to bid him farewell before, ever the rebel, letting herself back into the flat. She says under her breath, her anger evident in her words, "That was so embarrassing. You didn't have to kick him out. What was the purpose of the memo you were both penning?" "I wonder," I say. "I understand." All Sienna does is shrug. "You already know what I said. Just a blip." She walks by me as if she were about to return to her bedroom and shut the door and adds, "Just something for school." "It's not insignificant, Sienna. Was anything going to be said? Did I deserve it?" I inquire, but Sienna merely pulls a face, as if she were attempting to deny it but struggling to find the right words. In any case, it's irrelevant. The fact that the writing and envelope match the first note gives me the impression that it was meant for me, regardless of her words or silence. However, I can't help but wonder why she is so enraged that she would express her anger by attacking me. "Did you ask Dad to see how I was doing last night through text?" For the time being, I'll let the note go and inquire. "Since when did you begin to ask me that?" "I previously informed you no," she says with an adamant no before narrowing her eyes and barking again. I find it persuasive. I can't help but wonder how frequently Sienna lies and how many times I've been duped by her since I would have believed her if I hadn't recently seen proof to the contrary. My pocket still contains her phone. After dipping my index finger into it, I pull out my phone. A gasp escapes Sienna. "My phone? You stole it?" She reaches out to take it from my hand as if I'm the one who's wrong, her expression betraying her incredulity. "My phone, Sienna," I respond calmly, and no, I declined. Sienna, her face turning white from blood loss, glances down at her phone to read the message and figure out what else I might have seen. "You left it on the kitchen table, and I happened to see an incoming text from Dad." I hesitate for a while. "I don't understand why you lied to me about texting Dad last night." I continue while she remains silent. "Please tell me why you're sending me these terrible notes. You have no right to tell me the truth, Sienna. You know I can't get the word out because you placed that last note in the mailbox calling me a bitch." I ask, "What have I done to you?" I choke on it and then ask, battling tears, because I never thought my child would say something like that to me. Despite knowing she's been caught, Sienna keeps her composure. She shows no emotion and makes no apologies. Rather, she becomes furious and says, "I know what you did." I don't understand. As my confidence plummets, I ask cautiously, "I killed Caitlin Beckett with insulin." Sienna knows that. I also pushed her off a bridge. "Sienna, what are you trying to say?" Since she has remained silent, I must inquire once more. "My goodness, what did I do?" "She informed me," she explains. "Just who told you that?" "Girlfriend of Dad." "Hi, Caitlin. She informed me of your actions." I feel the tables turning as she says, "She told me Dad isn't my real dad." I reach out and embrace her, the comfort overwhelming me since she has no idea of the horrific things I've done. She only knows one. I whisper, "Sienna." "Don't even try to deny it," she adds, shoving me aside till I trip and fall. "You are aware that this is accurate." I find my footing. "At what point did she inform you of this?" "Next, I went to watch Dear Evan Hansen with my dad. The day after I returned home, she was already here. She spilled the beans to me." My jaw becomes clenched. At that moment, Caitlin took action. She got what she needed after I told her the truth about Sienna's biological father and emptied my heart to her, sharing things I had never told anyone else. I was outdone by her. I left for work the following day, leaving her to her own devices at my apartment. She rummaged through my belongings, found and stole my rings, and passed the time until Sienna returned home, at which point she could fill her in on what happened that night at Guthrie's. When Sienna returns home, she thinks she'll meet my pal, but instead she sees Caitlin. I try to picture Caitlin's words, wondering if she would have broken the news gently or taken pleasure in crushing Sienna's heart. I didn't discover that initial bitch message in the mailbox until a couple of weeks later, allowing Sienna plenty of time to stew over it, plot with Nico, and devise a revenge strategy against me. Sienna, I don't understand why you avoided conversations with me. Why don't you just come to me and tell me the truth instead of sending these terrible notes? In the same way that you were honest with me, she retorts, and her point is valid. The hypocrisy is obvious. Being dishonest myself gives me no authority to criticize her for being dishonest. Also, Sienna is 16 years old, and I imagine that writing these anonymous notes was her only option for communicating with me about her father and her emotions. Suddenly, Sienna's eyes well up with hot, furious tears. I despise you, she says with a snarl. As I stated in that note, I meant it. You disgust me. Somewhere in the basement, you should have met your demise. You should never have escaped, in my opinion. Lower level. I am astounded. My mind wanders to the night I was frightened and confined to the basement. It felt like more than just a coincidence when it happened. It had the air of purpose. Zuccotti was at home. She remained in the flat by herself. She actually ordered me to find the newborn images. As I close my eyes, a mental image forms of Sienna following me downstairs, locking me in with a door wedge, and then returning upstairs to do my homework under the blanket with her laptop, completely unconcerned that I would be unable to escape. How did that happen? I was so distraught and frightened when I eventually made it upstairs that she had to ask. No need to inquire about the incident, though. It was news to her. It's driving me crazy. I would like to take action against her. This will not go unpunished. This is not the way she should speak to me or swear at me. Sending hate mail or confining someone to the basement are both unacceptable. In what case would the neighbor's arrival home have been delayed? Was she planning to leave me there all night? Could she have claimed ignorance that I hadn't returned home by claiming she dozed off on the couch? However, my actions are even worse. And she is just reacting violently. She has every right to be furious. Someone else became pregnant with me. I gave her up to a person who isn't her biological father. Neither of them knew. I allowed them to live a lie for all these years. Is your dad in the know? Maintaining my composure, I inquire, as if she hadn't just swore at me or expressed her desire for my demise. Mom, is that really all that matters to you? Does Dad know, Dad? She asks before laughing sharply with an air of cynicism and mockery. Even my dad doesn't know him. I wish to embrace her. I wish I could reassure her. She deserves my deepest apologies, and I wish I could tell her the story of how I debated telling Ben the truth when I discovered she wasn't his, but eventually decided it was best for everyone involved. I am well aware that she will simply reject me if I try to reconnect with her. Hey, Sienna, did you tell him? Was he informed by her? Why are you even concerned? Reason being, he may cease paying child support. No, I respond. That is irrelevant to me. Please tell me, is he aware? He is unaware. Submit, Mom. He is completely unaware. At that moment, she confesses, because I didn't want to make him feel the way I do, and my heart sinks because I can sense the pain in her own broken heart. I cautiously approach her, placing my hand on her arm to gauge her reaction. When she remains still, I extend my arm toward her and embrace her tightly. Thanks, I'm relieved. I was wrong about our plans for the other night out with Ben. He came to comfort me, not harm me. He arrived because, as he mentioned, Sienna had requested that he see how I was doing. He was being really honest. After he and Caitlin broke up, I now believe that she acted out of spite, wrath, and envy by becoming close to me and trying to wreck my life by revealing Sienna about her father. Ben was completely uninvolved. I have no idea if he is aware that she has passed away. What comes next? With her face flushed and damp, Sienna inquires. Is there any chance that I will see him again? Indeed, you do, my darling. My attempt to reassure her that he is still her dad is met with silence as she reaffirms her hatred of me, abruptly withdraws from me, spins around, and dashes off to her room. The door bangs shut with such force that the picture on the other side smashes to the floor, breaking. I want to check on her to warn her to be careful with a shattered glass, but I restrain myself because I need to give her space, time to breathe, and to see if everything is all right. At this very moment, I fail to see how things may deteriorate more. 27. Luke sends me a text message. Hi there, the text appears. I was hoping to get a quick update on how you're doing. The writing is similar to a life buoy that rescuers throw into the water to help a person who is drowning. I cling to it, desperately trying to maintain my balance. I mean, really? Feeling under the weather. I'm a wreck, I declare. I collapse onto the sofa, my phone clenched in my fists, as I feel the tears welling up in my eyes, ready to burst. Would you like to discuss it? I think it would be too much to type into a text, but he asks nevertheless. I am completely at a loss for words. So much has transpired between Ben and Sienna, and I haven't seen Luke since the Caitlin incident. Luke texts me again before I can reply, proposing a bar between our flats, and acts as though he can read my thoughts. Let's meet for a drink. I love that. Keep in mind that Penelope was quite distressed the night that Luke worked late, and that she believed he was unfaithful to her by spending time with another lady. I don't want to separate you from her. I will be all right. I act like everything is easy and that time can heal all wounds by saying that I only need some space for things to settle down. Once again, Penelope is furious. I am being treated like a pest. It's selfish of me. After hearing Luke say, I could use a drink and someone to talk to too, I am filled with a sense of comfort. I don't intend for Penelope to feel enraged by him. The reason I say okay is because right now all I want to do is chat with a friend. Off the couch I get. I softly tap on Sienna's door. Without even trying to turn the knob, I say, Sienna, as I lean into it. What? She barks angrily. I inhale deeply. I have to go get a few things, I tell her, my conscience heavy with guilt about deceiving her once more. My absence will be brief. Sienna remains silent for what seems like an eternity. Is that all right with you? As I tread carefully, I inquire. Even I can remain at home. Tonight isn't the night I have to do it. When she says, just go, I'm unsure if I should listen, but eventually I make up my mind. Separation is necessary for Sienna. She requires some space to relax. No way would I suffocate her. After changing into my new clothing, I brush my hair. I give up trying to seem more put together with my makeup since nothing I do works. The cold air against my cheeks numbs me as I depart, and it's already dark outside. What Sienna needs is some alone time without me hovering over her shoulder, and I'm considering getting a drink and hanging out with a friend for myself. I'm not dwelling on the city's treatment of women as I saunter through the shadowy streets, abandoning Sienna in our flat. When I get there, Luke is already in the bar. We can use his table. As I make my way into the packed pub, he waves me over, and I return the gesture. As soon as I go to him, I take off my coat and sit down on a chair. Is it meant for me? I inquire as I notice a glass of white wine resting on the table. You are under no need to partake in the Chardonnay. I merely assumed you were a fan. You are welcome to choose an alternative item. My feelings will remain unharmed. No, I declare as I extend my hand to the object. This is absolutely ideal. I wanted it just this way. Thank you. With anticipation of the sedative effects of the wine, I raise the glass to my lips and take a sip. He whispers, I've been worried about you. As I set the glass back on the table, my fingers still entwined around its stem. How is the mood at work? I don't recall ever seeing Luke again after we crossed paths in the hallway just before Caitlin passed away. He proposed a double date with Penelope and her friend, but he was present at the hospital on the day of the insulin overdose. The story goes like this. I wouldn't mind hearing it from you if you're up to it. He pauses before continuing, the usual lots of exaggeration, white lies, and half-truths. Everything they claimed was probably true, in my opinion. Achieved it. It is my fault that she passed away. He says, listen, with a soothing tone in his voice. I feel a sense of relief as he places his palm on mine across the table. He hunches over. Show me a nurse who has never made a medical error in their entire career, and I will show you a liar. He then withdraws his hand, reaches for his cup, and takes a sip. Where did it come from? He lowers the drink and asks. Even with Luke, being truthful isn't an option, and I despise lying to him. I was cutting corners. My thoughts were racing because I was going too quickly. I failed to scan her wrist's barcode. That's nothing new for any of us. I was exhausted from not getting any sleep the night prior. You know how difficult it is to take time off when you're not feeling well. Nonetheless, I felt compelled to go into work anyhow. This is obviously not an excuse. It was my fault. I am responsible for this. We must not make such careless errors when lives are on the line. The moment she began coding, I realized my mistake and the dire repercussions it may bring. Dear Luke, my heart froze. A gasp escaped my lips. In all my years, I can't remember ever being that terrified. The worst part was being completely paralyzed. I can't stop telling myself that we could have saved her if I hadn't freaked out and acted faster. There was nothing you couldn't do. Nurse Megan, you do an excellent job. Believe me when I say that. I was an excellent nurse, I tell them. I think my time as a nurse is over. Administrative leave was granted to me by the hospital. It doesn't surprise me. I can't say that I hold it against them, but I do believe that my dismissal is imminent. I've considered leaving, and then outpunch them. Of course. I don't see why not. The job isn't that good anyway. The salary, the long hours. Despite my excessive cavalierness, he nods. My job is fantastic. However, I cherish my life and independence much more. What were Sienna's words? She is unaware. That's a tale for another day. For now, she just won't talk to me. She's currently unoccupied at home, thinking about how much she despises me and how I've messed up her life. I take a big sip of my wine. After observing my expression for a moment, Luke becomes silent and thoughtful before signaling the waitress to get me another drink as my current one is almost empty. Do you intend to inform me about it? As she walks away, he inquires. With a quick and firm, no, I respond. It's embarrassing for everyone to know my secret, but I really want to tell you. What would Luke think of me if he found out that I let Ben to raise a child who wasn't even his for more than 16 years? My time has come. I'm being extremely negative. Describe Penelope for me. Knowing that I'm not alone at this chaotic time will help me cope. Luke offers an empathic smile. Variety in the battle. Neither what I say nor do is correct. When the baby is here, I pray that everything returns to normal. He seems discouraged, weary, and dejected. Although I feel bad for him, I can also relate to Penelope's current pregnancy situation. Even though I'm not in the most encouraging mood, I say, I'm sure they will, in an effort to be encouraging. Penelope is experiencing a challenging period. All the hormones, the bed rest, and fretting over the baby's well-being. It probably feels like too much, and all by himself. Shortly after, my phone starts ringing. From within my backpack, I can barely make out its voice, so I reach in and start rummaging. I take the phone out of its hiding place and examine it, hoping without hope that it's Sienna wanting me to return home so we can chat. However, the number displayed on the caller ID is a local 773 number, which I am unfamiliar with. I have a moment of nausea whenever I consider the possibility that the cops may have seen me in the hospital earlier and are now searching for me. Can you tell me who this is? I flip my phone over so Luke can see it when he asks. To be honest, I'm confused. No one in my address book. Then it's likely a telemarketer. With a subtle motion toward his glass, he replies, "Just ignore it." I nod in agreement and place the phone on the table. The waitress then brings my wine, and I express my gratitude by thanking her. I usually wouldn't have a second glass of wine, and I doubt I'd even need one, but I'm making an exception for today. Following a brief pause, Luke continues, "Listen, I despise to do this, but I should return home and see whether Penelope is prepared to speak." I give my assent. He needs to go make amends with her, but I'd rather he stay. "How are you doing?" He finishes his drink and asks, "I think so. Kindly depart." "Is that so? Your comment about her feeling lonely is all. I was moved. Now I'm feeling bad." "Absolutely, without a doubt. Luke, you're an admiral. Just like Penelope and yourself, you are also going through a difficult time. The arrival of the kid will make everything better, I assure you." "So what's your plan?" With a thoughtful expression on his face, he asks, "Will you be staying for a while, or are you also going home?" I inform him that I intend to remain for some time. "Once I finish my drink, I'll go home. Sienna is likely happier apart from me, and I'm not in a hurry to return home." "Very well," he responds. "I may return if Penelope tells me to leave." Smirking, I say, "I can secure a seat for you." With a wink, he continues, "I always knew I could count on you," after finishing his beer. As he walks out, I go back to nursing my glass of wine, appreciative of the background noise from the packed bar. It provides a pleasant diversion. As I observe others, I can't help but feel envious of their joy and camaraderie. Time seems to slip my mind. After about half an hour or so, my phone rings again, and this time I check to see if Sienna is on the other end, but she isn't. During Luke's previous visit, this is the same local number that called. Who could it be? Why would they call twice? My anxiety levels are through the roof. For some reason, I'm anticipating the voice on the other end of the line to be strong, aggressive, or masculine, but that's not the case this time around. I hold the phone up to my ear and answer the call nevertheless. "Is this Megan Michaels?" a woman asks, her voice filled with hesitation. "I believe that's her." "I am Megan." "Good day. Hello, I am Penelope Albrecht." "Mrs. Luke, your number was in some of his possessions. I apologize for the abruptness of this call." "Is this Penelope?" incredulous, I inquire. "We last had a conversation a long time ago. At Luke and her wedding, we had a brief, fleeting nice to meet you, but that was our only encounter." "Do you know where he is? What's wrong?" she says, her expression betraying her distress. I'm at a loss for words, afraid to add to her misery. I would like not to embarrass him. Though I appreciate him coming to see me tonight, I fear she will be furious if she finds out he was with me. However, my mind wanders to the fact that Penelope is quite pregnant, leading me to question whether the baby is ill or if she has already gone into labor. Sincerely, I respond with a yes. "Just about 20 or 30 minutes ago, I laid eyes on him. Right now, he's heading home." As I ask why Luke hasn't returned home yet, I try to convince myself that he might have stopped for ice cream or flowers on his way as a gesture of goodwill, and that he should be there any minute. "My apologies. Kindly refrain from taking offense at him." "My mistake. I wanted to discuss an incident that occurred at work, so I invited him to meet with me." "I don't think so," Penelope comments after initially remaining silent. "I really doubt he'll be returning home." Her words are just breathtaking. "Penelope, is everything all right?" In a low voice, I wonder if their argument was even worse than Luke made it sound. "Are you and the baby doing all right? Can you tell me what to do?" Silence envelops her. Rather, she states, "The police were just here at our apartment," which causes me to change gears and fall into a flat spin because it implies that they came seeking for me after I saw them at the hospital. Before heading to Luke's, they must have stopped by my residence. It was probably after I had already gone to meet him. My mind wanders to a scene where Sienna is home alone, answering the intercom and granting them entry. They must have told her something, right? Did they hear what she would have said? "Where are you?" Penelope inquires. "Yes," I utter under my breath. "My apologies. Yes, I am here." What were their desires? Who said what? It was their desire to speak with Luke. I nod, my stomach turning. Without a doubt, they did. Luke is the target of the police's interest because they want to question him about me. This is all a part of their investigation, and I really wish I could have a conversation with him before he returns home. I really want him to defend me, to tell me that Megan would never intentionally hurt a patient. I want him to tell me that it's impossible, that she just doesn't have the heart to hurt anyone. Unfortunately, Luke wasn't in Caitlin's hospital room that day, so he didn't see anything. An arrest warrant had been issued for him. I feel a parched throat. My skin loses its color. "What?" I ask, my mind scrambling to make sense of something that has caught me entirely off guard. "I really don't get it, not at all." She says, "His DNA, Megan," interjecting. "It was discovered beneath the fingernails of the previous woman. Their paths crossed. His explanation that he had nicked his neck while shaving was convincing, so I believed him when I noticed the mark on his neck recently." "Woman?" Penelope asked. "Please explain. Can you repeat yourself?" "Megan, think about all the women who have been the victims of assault. You guessed it, Luke. It's Luke who has been causing them pain." I begin to tremble. My wine glass slips from my fingers and crashes to the floor, pouring all over my lap. I can feel the icy dew on my denim leg. No way is this correct. Presumably, she is incorrect. Nobody but Luke. Those women were too vulnerable for Luke to harm. That can't be done. Then I remember my criminal justice class in college when we studied serial murderers and sexual predators. I discovered that they appear really ordinary. That is, one would not immediately assume that they are predators just by looking at them. Typical people in this situation have regular employment, families, mortgages, 401ks, and spouses and children. I recall what Luke shared with me about his background. A troubled adolescent, a father who was abusive and generally gone from his upbringing, and a history of criminality and a spell in juvenile detention before he reportedly turned his life around. But suppose he reconsidered? Suppose he simply became more adept at concealing his wrongdoing? What if, as time went on, his violent behavior only escalated? 30 minutes ago, when Penelope called, Luke glanced at the number on the screen. He departed about 2 minutes after she phoned. "Greg? Stayed or what?" "Yes." "Megan, there's more. Take a deep breath. That's why I'm phoning you. I went through his belongings after the police had departed. A shoebox was in our closet," Penelope says, her speech stuttering as she struggles to explain. "A shoebox among many other shoeboxes was all it was. It never occurred to me that anything was amiss. However, Megan, there were things within." "Which things?" "He saved online newspaper articles, a locket shaped like a heart." She pauses, her voice quivering, "a woman's thong." "Mementos," I whisper, my palm moving to my mouth as my stomach turns at the idea of Luke stealing a woman's underwear from someone's apartment and putting them in his pocket as a memento, something to hold on to as he leaves her screaming and terrified for her life. "I think so." Also included in the package was an image, observed from across the street outside a 3-flat. "Whose likeness is it?" "It was of you, Megan," she says with a pause, reluctant to add, "and your daughter. I believe he took it without your knowledge. My lungs are emptying. Please send me a photo of it via SMS." Yes, she does. Upon expanding the shot, I see that Sienna and I emerged from our flat at some point in the fall, when the weather was dry and the trees were shedding their orange and brown leaves, which were accumulating on the sidewalk and street. The photo actually only shows Sienna and not the two of us. As I stand in the corner, my back to the camera, I draw the door shut and Penelope can just make out my features just enough to identify me in this tightly focused shot of her face. In my mind, Luke is standing across the street from our apartment, discreetly photographing Sienna from behind a parked car or even one of the steel structural beams of the L. He would kindly inquire about her well-being, academic progress, and romantic status at all times. I always just saw it as him being considerate. As I recall, the blood runs down my face. I just informed Luke that Sienna is home alone. 28. I initially contact Sienna. As I squeeze my way out of the packed pub, I dial 911 in the event that she doesn't pick up. I warn the dispatcher that my child could be in danger from Luke Albrecht, the man the police believe is responsible for the attacks on those women in the city. His arrest is warranted by the authorities. At home by herself, my daughter is. Nobody is picking up her phone. When I finally manage to get outside, I'm panting and breathless. Then I turn and run clumsily down the street, saying, "Please, hurry." "How can I find the address, ma'am?" she inquires, and I inform her. "What is your daughter's age?" "Oh, 16. I sprint home, ignoring red lights in favor of dodging traffic, which results in honking and slamming on brakes from automobiles as they try to keep up with me. I beat the cops to the bar's front door by racing up the steps outside and escorting them two at a time since it's only a few blocks away. I swear profanely as I rummage through my backpack for my keys. Eventually, I find them and pull open the door. Then I dash inside, clumsily, tripping and falling to my knees on the maroon carpeting once. However, I quickly get back up and continue running. Upon reaching the third level, I enter the apartment through the door, accidentally bumping into someone's shoulder while doing so. I yell, "Sienna," as I dash from room to room. "My darling Sienna." I'm praying that she'll magically emerge from her room and ask what. When she lays eyes on me, turned off by my apparent distress and the sound of my voice, which is both urgent and piercing. "No, she isn't." The lamp in Sienna's room is lit. Fearing the worst, I step inside. I imagine her lying beneath the blankets, watching a movie on her laptop with the covering drawn back, as if time had stopped the second Luke walked in. Then I hear the buzz of the front door. I witness her rising from her slumber, stepping to the intercom, casting her gaze out the bay window towards the street and catching sight of Luke. On her bed, halfway under a pink throw, you can find her phone. Knowing that Sienna would never knowingly or willingly leave her phone behind, I instinctively go for it and slide it out. That would be the only explanation if she was evicted from the residence against her choice. My knees weaken under me, and my hand goes to my lips. I am on the verge of collapsing, sobbing uncontrollably. In any case, I am too busy to go to pieces right now. I really need to locate Sienna, but I can't do it without her phone. Huge is the city. I lack the benefit of life 360, and she may be anywhere. I open the door to the apartment for the cops when they came. They stand in the cramped living room and inquire. They want me to explain everything all over again. I remember what Sienna was wearing when we were arguing before she said, "I fucking hate you, and you are a bitch," and now I'm wondering if she changed into her pajamas after I left. This makes me wonder if Luke allowed her to take her shoes and coat with her when she left, or if she's cold and barefoot somewhere. They want to see pictures of Sienna. On this gloomy, frigid January night, I can't bear to imagine Sienna in her typical sleepwear, a pair of plaid flannel boxer shorts and a boxy, cropped t-shirt bearing her stomach in the freezing cold. The fact that Sienna has gone missing and the authorities' concerns for her safety have prompted the issuance of an Amber Alert. "What comes next? What do you think?" I inquire. "Together with Mr. Albrecht, we will be on the lookout for her. But for the time being, you must remain here in case your daughter returns home alone," the officer states. I nod in agreement, my voice tinged with emotion, but I am aware that it is not true. My stay here will be brief. As long as Sienna is in danger, I will not remain still. She relies on me. After the cops depart, I check my call log for Penelope's number and give her a call. Penelope, my daughter, is in his hold. He abducted her. Oh, my soul. Megan, her words dripping with embarrassment and guilt. She pretends she's sorry as if it were her fault. Perhaps it is. Perhaps she was aware of his actions in her subconscious. Every time Luke walked me out the door at the conclusion of my shift, I remember his heartfelt goodbye. My mental image is of him getting off work, raping and stalking women before returning to Penelope. My mind races with everything I've learned about this man from the news. He would lurk in the shadows, waiting for ladies to unlock their doors so he could stalk them from behind and threaten their lives. As I writhe in pain, my mind races to the thought of Sienna by herself with him. Megan, are you all right? When I am unable to answer her question, she continues, Megan? For Sienna's sake, I pull myself up and get my act together. I use the sleeve of my shirt to dab at my face. Is there any possible place he could have taken her or be at the moment? Every word that Luke has ever spoken to me is replayed in my head. I was mistaken about how well I knew him, ponders Penelope. On occasion, he'll use the 606. While thinking aloud, she runs through all of Luke's past locations and concludes that he might follow the lakefront trail to Northerly Island. He proposed to me in the Art Institute's South Garden. However, that is incorrect. In fact, none of these locations are appropriate because they are outdoors and open to the public. Luke's strategy, his plan, is to target women in their homes or hidden areas of apartment buildings. The only place he couldn't harm Sienna in ours would be when I returned home and discovered him. Is there anything else that comes to mind? I wonder, I say. Somewhere far away from civilization. My apologies, Megan. Not me. She adds, I'm stuck. Please try again. I'll be here if you come up with anything. I tell her it's all right, but that she should keep trying. Within the next 5 minutes, I get a text message from Luke with the following details. Come alone. The address is on Leavitt Street. Remain silent. Sienna will cover the cost if you do that. For fear of Luke's possible actions toward Sienna, I contemplate contacting the authorities, but ultimately decide against it. I simply get in my cab, sprint down Dakin Street to Sheridan, and then lean forward in my seat to give the driver the address. Persuade him, please, to move quickly. Our arrival takes an interminable amount of time. The house on Leavitt is very new. It's probably a teardown. The Tyvek House wrap is still visible on the outside, and it's wedged between two existing single-family homes. Because there are no openings whatsoever, the interior is dreary and winter creeps in, bringing back chilling memories of Sienna, who was both chilled to death and terrified. Luke hasn't turned on any lights, but I don't think that's the problem. The lack of electricity in the house is the real culprit. I enter the backyard by slipping down the thin gangway that separates the houses and step into the little, narrower-than-wide yard. Additionally, the house lacks a back entrance and utilizes plastic construction sheeting as the sole means of preventing the entry of cold winter air. I cautiously insert an arm inside, retraction of the plastic allowing me to pass and then enter the residence. The darkness has me confused. Please give me some time so my eyes can adjust. We are approaching a full moon. As I cautiously make my way across the subfloor, I can barely make out the outline of the house, but what I can make out is the wooden studs, vertical beams, and rough holes for windows and doors illuminated by the outside streetlight. Please tell me what I'm getting into. I intend to catch Luke unawares. I reduce the quantity of oxygen I inhale till my lungs ache from holding my breath. The biting cold air ensures that the temperature inside the house cannot exceed 40 degrees. As I make my way around the first floor, clinging to the wooden beams for support, I can't shake the sensation that someone is watching me. I feel the hairs on the back of my neck stand on end as my back naturally arches. I jerk my head frantically toward the direction of the rear, where I imagine Luke to be a figure in the shadows, but I can't see him. I must be completely alone. However, a muted sound like someone gently sobbing emerges from upstairs. Like a mother's intuition, I don't really hear it, but I sense it deep within. The stairs are on my way. Their ascent begins with me. So far, there are only treads, no risers. Additionally, there are no handrails, and I find it easy to lose my footing in the dark without them. My thighs hurt from trying to walk slowly and quietly since my legs are weak and trembling. I make it to the second level, and it's exactly like the first. I go from one room to another, hopping from beam to beam. After hearing the words, "You made it," I whirled around to see Luke standing in a chamber off to the side, with beams separating him from me. "Someone told me you were going to show up. She is mine to give to you. Surely I could." "I wonder," I say. I slowly adjust my vision to find Sienna standing next to him. As the moonlight filters in from behind, it barely illuminates her, allowing me to make out her trembling, laborious, terrified breaths as she lies on her knees on the hard floorboards. She has a complete convulsion due to the cold and fright, not only the occasional shiver. Behind her, Luke stands as the puppet master puts a gun to Sienna's head while she whimpers, her tears falling gently but surely. "Please stop," Luke pleads as I approach her. "Megan, please don't get any closer." I want to sprint over to comfort Sienna as she sobs in a terrified voice, but I hold back due to the gun. I'm afraid Luke will not think twice about pulling the trigger if I don't. "For what reason, my darling?" I tell her. "You don't have anything to apologize for. I'll do anything." Then I turn to Luke. I humbly implore him. "Come get me. Stop clinging to Sienna." "I'm not going to jail, Megan," Luke insists, his voice perfectly managed. "I don't understand why we're here, Luke. For what reason were Sienna and I brought here? Please tell me where I am." His condition deteriorates rapidly. Even if he relaxes and rounds his shoulders, the gun is still aimed at Sienna's head. Although I was unaware that it was this mansion, I recall him explaining to me how he had brought Penelope to see it. Their one-bedroom apartment wasn't going to cut it for their expanding family, so he took her house hunting before she was even pregnant. He expressed his hope that he could have bought a single-family home for them. To be a good father meant providing for my family, and that is exactly what I set out to do. I mentioned my own dad before, didn't I? "Yes," I respond. "It was better when Luke's father wasn't around. He was a horrible, abusive drunk. In a never-ending loop of drinking and abuse, he would go on binges, hit Luke and his mom, and then disappear. He would return days or weeks later to continue the pattern. I had no desire to emulate his behavior. To be better, I aspired to accomplish better." I whisper, "And you are, to make him feel better. Megan, you can't fucking lie to me." "I'm worse," he declares, and he's not wrong. So much worse has been done by Luke. How many women has he harmed? I've lost count. For both of us, this house was meant to represent a beginning anew. He claims to have brought Penelope here. Upon entering, I showed her about and gave her a tour of the property. I informed her that I planned to buy it for our family and raise our children here, and you know what she said? I quietly say, "No," my fear mounting as I listen. "What?" She told me I was completely insane to believe I could ever afford this house. I grimace. Her remarks hurt. "I apologize, Luke. It was wrong of her." Rest assured, she expressed her remorse at a later time. "Sometimes I get these stupid ideas in my head and can't be talked out of them," she remarked, adding, "I should have said it like that, but I had to be so blunt." "Luke, this house must be worth $1 million, I whisper softly. "Few can manage to pay for it. You remain just as manly despite it. Do not let this derail your success." Out of nowhere, he stands up straight and his head snaps up. He asks Megan, "What do you think about that?" as he adjusts his hold on the revolver. "To be a total dud." In a quick and hurried manner, I respond positively, "Definitely not. That is completely out of my mind. Luke, you're an admiral. What a stunning nurse. Consider all the lives you've touched and the patients you've cared for throughout the years. Please, look down on me. Stop being so condescending toward me. I give up trying to convince him otherwise because he is a master manipulator. I switch tactics. What are your expectations of us? Is Sienna something you're after? My gaze drifts to her as I inquire, curious as to whether he ever touched her in any way. Do you feel any pain? She seems distraught as she shakes her head in response to my question. Thanks to Sienna and you, I'll be able to figure out how to escape this mess, Luke assures me. He wants our assistance fleeing the city, so he kidnapped her and is holding her prisoner. All right, I respond with a nod. Everything you asked for, we can accomplish. Luke, what's wrong? Is it money? A vehicle? If you need money to rent a car and leave this place, I can offer you as much as you need. I have a savings account. The remaining portion of my grandma's bequest, that which was not previously appropriated, is in my possession. All I have to do is withdraw it from the bank. Luke laughs. How on earth do you believe you can simply withdraw that amount of money from the bank? The question is posed by him. Of course I could. However, I am unable to complete everything within a single day, and I will not be able to do it tonight, as the bank is already closed. So, it's the ATM. Go ahead and let Sienna and I use the ATM to withdraw as much money as we can. It will be returned. As he raises his voice and shouts, "Be honest with me, Megan," Sienna breaks down and presses her eyes shut tightly, waiting for the pistol to go off. If I allow Sienna to go, what are the chances of your return? Then release Sienna, I implore. You should keep me. Oh, please. Set her free. I'll wait here till she receives the cash from the machine. With the rental automobile I can give you, you should be able to leave the state. Luke, the law enforcement is on the hunt for you. Renting a car on your own is something I'm not sure about. Count on me. I will arrange for a car while Sienna goes and gets the money. How could he harm so many women? I want to know why he did it. I wish I could question him about his confidence in his ability to escape punishment. The cops will pursue him no matter where he goes. Murder and rape are already serious crimes. If he shoots Sienna and me, it will be far worse. Is that acceptable, Luke? I beg, I'm frantic, while he remains silent. What if I stay here with you to arrange for a rental car while Sienna gets cash from the ATM? Then you can leave, right? And just then, Luke's ears perk up. He listens as his head whirls to the stairs, and then he narrows his eyes and turns back to face me. Megan, did you contact the authorities? Is my whereabouts known to them? My jaw becomes clenched. Please, reply to me. In the midst of my quiet, his voice echoes with a scream. On his side, Sienna contorts herself into a ball, swaying back and forth as she wraps her arms around her legs. It annoys him. He grabs Sienna by the hair and pulls her up, causing her to moan in pain as she falls to her knees once more. He grips her hair tightly. Now that the barrel is digging more in, Sienna's sobbing is more urgent and heaving, and she is preparing to die. No, I respond. I did not contact the authorities, Luke. I swear to God. My instinct tells me to come closer, but Luke suddenly turns the pistol toward me. I manage to stop in my tracks, and then he turns it back to Sienna, which is much worse. I came alone as you instructed. You have my word, Luke. I assure you, no way would I deceive. A sudden, ear-piercing boom rips through the darkness from behind, and then another. A brief burst of brilliant yellow light briefly illuminates the chamber before darkness falls again. The flash is caused by the bullet eluding Luke's gun. Luke stumbles backwards as Sienna plummets downward, slamming her face into the ground. Subfloors are covered in oceans of blood, which is spreading. On my way to Sienna, I brake hard. Suddenly, an officer materializes and blocks my path. I forcefully collide with him. With a "ma'am," he seizes me and holds me tightly. He insists that I not enter and refuses to allow me pass. I unleash a piercing scream as I pound on his chest with my fists. The cop catches me just as I'm about to fall because my legs give out. He rescues me, he supports me. Dear Sienna, my darling, I yell over the police officer's helmet. I'm right here, I say, focusing my strength as I meet the officer's gaze. I eventually got him to agree to let me see my kid. Exit the room. Release your grip on me. And how is she doing? Will she be okay? Blood is all over the place. Upon her garments. The texture of her skin. It turns her hair a fiery red. Her arms drooped beneath her, and her red hair fanned over her head as she lies still on the floor, hanging at an odd angle. I can't help but worry if this is the punishment I'll get for murdering Caitlin Beckett. 29. On a stretcher, the paramedics transport Sienna to the waiting ambulance. As I lag behind, I feel the hand of someone guiding me down the stairs and out into the snow. While onlookers gather on the street, emergency medical technicians carefully transfer Sienna to the rear of the ambulance, where the glare of the overhead lights intensifies the visibility of the blood. Paramedics rush to the scene of the crime to determine how to stem the flow of blood and locate the entry point of the gunshot. As if in a dream, I stand by and observe. The chill doesn't even register with me. Until someone comes up behind me and puts a blanket on my shoulders, I have no idea that I'm trembling. It does not occur in my view. I don't sense it occurring. The blanket appears out of nowhere, drooping and clinging precariously. Then it begins to fall, and someone rushes over to catch it. They secure it to my palm, and I can't help but feel a shiver down my spine as I replay in my head the sequence of events. The police officers sneaked into the house from behind and shot Luke before he could fire the gun he was holding. Luke passed away. As officers enter and exit the residence, encircling the vicinity with crime scene tape, he remains inside. Night is filled with lights and sirens, which are multiplying. The press arrives. I can't take my gaze off of Sienna in the back of the ambulance, so the video cameras, microphones, and spotlights are all in my peripheral view. An emergency medical technician approaches me, and I get ready to hear the devastating news that Sienna's hemorrhage was too great to be salvaged. "She's all right," he states. "Wah, I." My speech is elided. "However, blood. Wow, there's a lot." Fortunately, her injuries are not serious or even life-threatening. A sprained ankle, a few scrapes and bruises. He mentions the blood, though. It was never hers. We still make it to the emergency room. First responders want Sienna to see a doctor because, if nothing else, she hurt her ankle in a fall in the dark at home and needs x-rays to see if it's fractured or sprained. As the doctor approaches, she remains still on a hospital bed. I stand at her side, unable to comprehend that she is alive and, for the most part, physically well, but her mental well-being is a different matter entirely. A police officer informed me that Penelope had contacted the authorities before we set out for the hospital. After some consideration, she recalled Luke's fixation on the house and the possibility that it could serve as a hiding place for him. "He said something happened to you," Sienna adds. "What happened?" She says, "Luke," and I have to keep telling myself that the blood on her face and hair isn't hers. Rather, it belongs to Luke. "His word is that you were severely injured. He assured me that he would bring me to you if I accompanied him." Her eyes well up with tears as she speaks. Upon Luke's arrival, she would have undoubtedly opened the door for him. Known to Sienna is Luke. I can't stop gushing about him, even though they've only met a handful of times. Sienna would have believed Luke if he had buzzed up to our apartment door and claimed something terrible had happened to me. "I was very frightened. You were the one I thought I'd lost. All these hurtful things I said kept running through my head, and I wondered, what if those were my last words to you?" As she struggles to find the right words, her shoulders ache and her face contorts into a sob. "You aren't hated by me." As I draw her closer, I whisper, "I know, honey, I know." I am relieved when she doesn't fight me, but instead sags and clings to me. I run my fingers through her hair and whisper, "I was just as scared. When I learned about Luke, his identity, his actions, and the fact that you were associated with him." When I speak, my voice quivers. It's difficult to put into words how near I was to losing her tonight. My deepest apologies, Sienna. Regarding all matters, regarding Luke, I accepted that man into our life. Regarding your father, too. In order to meet my gaze, Sienna steps back. With an air of desperation, she asks, Mom, can we keep that between us? I've been thinking about it for a while. Could you please? He will only suffer harm if he is aware of it. It will serve no useful purpose. Finding my biological father isn't something I'm interested in doing, and it would be strange if Dad found out. After this, everything will change. What does it mean? Bliss is innocence. I softly correct her, ignorance, while secretly questioning whether Ben really needs to know that he isn't Sienna's father and whether Sienna and I could really keep this secret from him. I agree with Sienna that his knowledge will serve no useful purpose. This will have the opposite effect of what someone wants. Everything will become a jumbled mess when he feels like he's lost a child and then has to pay back past custody payments. Feelings may be wounded. Inevitably, Ben will endure more hardship than the rest of us. Is informing him necessary? Please help me, Sienna says. Tell him your story. As Ben and the nurse lead him behind the curtain, I hear a noise behind us and quickly turn around to see where he came from. He turns to thank her, and I let him in while I ponder how much of our conversation between Sienna and me Ben overheard while he stood outside the curtain. Since that fateful night in my flat, Ben has eluded me. Looking back, I see how far I went in believing he was out to harm me. Now I know the truth. He came just because he cared about me and because Sienna requested him to. He came to check on me because he was concerned about my well-being and perhaps because he still had feelings for me. Even though it's implausible, I can't help but imagine how it would affect me if I discovered at this second that Sienna wasn't mine. I would be crushed. The doctor, I say, attempting to maintain a low voice. As I wait for thought to occur, I feel Sienna's firm grasp on my hand from behind and swallow. The doctor was the subject of her speech. A tetanus vaccine is something that Sienna is concerned about. To answer her question, yes, we should inform the doctor about this scratch. All across one house, you could see bare nails. As we meet each other's eyes, I turn to Sienna and warn her. You can't be taking any chances with tetanus. She nods in agreement, as if we had made a secret agreement. We will keep Sienna's biological father a secret from Ben. At this moment, no. At no point in time. Ben ignores me and rushes over to her, embracing her tightly. Even as he says, I'll be right here when they do it, my eyes well up with tears. Your hand is in my grasp. Even if he isn't her biological father, I know that he is and always will be her father, therefore it won't hurt. While they bring Sienna in for her ankle x-rays, Ben and I wait alone in the waiting area for 30 minutes. When I meet Ben's timid gaze, he timidly continues, about the other night. His eyes reveal a hopeful, almost beseeching, sincere expression. Every time I think about that night, I remember how many times he called me. Every single one of those voicemails and texts inviting me over or offering to cook dinner. His belief that we could reconcile was sincere. Remembering how he hugged me and comforted me that night in my apartment brings back a flood of memories of his solicitude. His weight pushing down on me as he ran his hand under my shirt hem and the way I wanted him all come to me. Additionally, I can't help but think about his insensitive and irritable reaction to Sienna's text messages, as well as his impulsive behavior, childish behavior, and prioritization of his own wants above hers. These two guys are named Ben. I adore you, Ben. I abruptly end the conversation by saying, I will always love you, but not in that way. I apologize for deceiving you. I am not sure what motivated me that night. With a gesture that is both familiar and reassuring, he reaches out to take my hand and nods. Hey, he adds with a faint grin, holding his hat in a modest manner, it was worth a try. Leaning into his embrace, I realize that we are family despite our differences and the hardships we have endured. He puts his arm around my shoulders and I lean into him. Epilogue. After over a month off, I am returning to work today. February has arrived. The forecast for spring brightens the otherwise gloomy days, yet they aren't any warmer either. As I make my way to the hospital as usual, a mix of emotions washes over me. A mix of nostalgia and nervousness about how my coworkers will receive my return. Additionally, I am concerned about Sienna while she is alone in our apartment getting ready for school. Despite reminding her to text at least twice before leaving the apartment and again once arriving at school, I am still physically ill at the thought of missing my first morning without her presence. Even the thought of her being in her bedroom, even 20 feet away, makes me uncomfortable. After what happened with Luke, I wanted to accompany her to school the first day back so I could make sure she got there safely. Even though it's been a lot of weeks, the thought of her covered in someone else's blood or of Luke standing behind her in the dark, deserted house with a gun to her head still haunts me. I know it wasn't healthy to project my fears onto her, but the world can be a dangerous place. I get to the hospital and enter with apprehension, my stomach knotted in anticipation of the elevator. When it came to Caitlin's case, the State Board of Nursing was very lenient with me. My nearly 20 years of experience in the field, my admission that I had given her the wrong insulin by accident, and my honesty all played a role. Nothing similar has ever happened at work before. I am currently permitted to work while I am under probation and am being closely supervised by both the hospital and the board. This is not always the case. I could have just lost my license, but the reality is that patients are less safe since fewer nurses would disclose errors when punishment is harsh. There will be more deceit and cover-ups. Nonetheless, I did not accidentally give Caitlin someone else's insulin. Yet, no one else is aware of this. Into the unit I go. Despite taking the life of a patient, I am not as inquisitive as I had anticipated. On the contrary, Luke is, and if people rush up to me exclaiming, "Oh my God, Megan," it immediately allays my anxieties of returning. When I say, "I heard what happened," what they really mean is that they are discussing the fact that Luke abducted Sienna, and that my daughter and I witnessed his death at the hands of the police, rather than the fact that I murdered a patient. "All right," I nod and respond yes when Bridget asks in the break room, even though I'm not. I'm not sure if I will ever be completely okay, but I'm making an effort. Day by day, it becomes easier. An additional nurse envelops me in her embrace and whispers, "I've missed you. Thank goodness you're back. It was Luke the whole time. I can't believe it." What sort of individual would engage in such behavior? My day is going well. It is a pleasure to return. After I get home that night, Ben comes to get Sienna, who is in her room getting ready for the weekend, and he's really gentle with her this time. I leave feeling lighter and happier. He stands in my living room, beer in hand, asking about my day, rather than being irritated by having to wait. "I have something for you," he adds once I've done briefing him on work. "As for I, you didn't have to do that," I remark, preoccupied with my own foolish thoughts about Ben buying me something and my mixed feelings about not being able to repay him. I'm worried he didn't hear me when I told him in the hospital that we weren't getting back together, and he still thinks it's possible. I can't help but wonder how many times I'll have to decline his requests. On the coffee table, he places his beer. "Stand with your eyes closed and your hand extended." "Ben," I say, feeling foolish. "Just Fabis," he whispers softly, "please, before Sienna comes out," and I comply. I gently close my eyes and extend a hand, palm facing up. I can feel Ben's warm hand grabbing onto my fingers as I cling on for an extra minute, waiting for him to place his gift on top of my hand. It feels almost weightless. Until Ben murmurs, "All right," I hardly notice it's there. "Feel free to open your eyes." Indeed, I do. In the blink of an eye, I notice Ben staring at me, his own eyes sparkling and a small smile teasing his lips. I can't help but return his smile. It's infectious. My grin, though, disappears when I examine the object in my palm. My engagement ring has gone missing. What happened? How did it happen? I beg, struggling to find the right words. His condo, he explains. It defies explanation. Is it possible that Sienna accidentally stole it and abandoned it? I am not sure. An upward glance eludes me. We lock gazes, and I make a fruitless effort to decipher his expression, trying to figure out whether he's being truthful or if he's hiding something. I respond with a yeah, maybe, but in reality, it went otherwise. The ring was not accepted by Sienna. The responsibility was with Caitlin. The day she went, the day she informed Sienna she wasn't Ben's, she also grabbed my rings. What happened after that is unclear because, in theory, Ben and Caitlin had already broken up. What gave rise to the ring in his place in the event that their relationship had ended? Was it that very day that she returned to tell him the truth about me? Was it her intention to flee the ring by breaking into his condo? Perhaps their romance had already ended. Imagine if Ben lied to me and said it was just to confuse me. I actually thought you might be interested in having it returned, he remarks. Without a doubt, yes. Indeed, I do. I failed to. I had no idea it had disappeared. I mistook my jewelry box for its hiding place. A shrug escapes his lips. He finally gets it back where it belongs, and that's the only thing that matters, he says. Caressing my cheek with an innocent kiss, he draws near. As I feel my heart racing and my cheeks flushing with heat, he draws away, his intense gaze fixed on me for an extended period of time. Suddenly, the door to Sienna's bedroom swings open, and she materializes from behind us. Am I prepared? She responds, yes, when Ben asks, letting go and looking past me. Ben is turning to leave the apartment with Sienna, and I can't help but feel that I'll never know the full extent of his knowledge. For all I know, he may always have the upper hand. Perhaps I would have been caught in the end.